Great. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. I am so much looking forward to this session. Primary care is both the most important and the most neglected aspect of our healthcare system. There are so few success stories around the world. For middle-income countries and low-income countries, you can virtually count on one hand the number of primary healthcare systems that are effective, responsive, and two of them are represented in this conversation. Thailand and Costa Rica are really showing the world the way to go forward in effective primary care. What we want to focus on here is, how did that happen? What are the politics of primary health care? My field is public health, and in public health, we recognize that often what we do is good for most people, but bad for some special interests, and tends not to be strongly popular politically. Primary care is in some ways similar in that it's good for people, but not necessarily something that in most countries has political salience. Hospitals tend to be more powerful than primary care centers. Specialists tend to be more venerated than our primary care practitioners. Teams of primary care workers, including nurses, community health workers, and pharmacists, tend not to have the attention, the focus, the respect, the salaries they need so that they can be recruited and function effectively. I've had the honor of seeing first person and only reading about the Costa Rican primary healthcare program, and I've been deeply impressed with both. So I want to first introduce to you each of our speakers. First, Dr. Román Macaya is the executive president of the Costa Rican Social Security Fund. He was previously ambassador of Costa Rica to the U.S. from 2014 to 2018. He has a master's in business administration in healthcare management from the Wharton School of Business and a PhD in biochemistry from UCLA. Dr. Viroj is senior expert in health economics at the Ministry of Public Health of Thailand. He's an advisor to its International Health Policy Program, and he heads the research hub for the Asia-Pacific Observatory. He chaired negotiations of the World Health Organization Global Code of Practice on the international recruitment of health personnel, and he served for 9 years in rural district hospitals in provinces of Thailand. He received his PhD in health planning and financing at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. I'm deeply honored to be joined by each of them. We're going to have, I hope, a very informative discussion, an interactive discussion. I will say that this is a session that I have been deeply looking forward to for weeks. So without further ado, I'll first turn it over to Dr. Macaya for some introductory remarks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Frieden. And it's a pleasure to be on this panel with my colleague from Thailand and with this very esteemed audience. The subject matter is of tremendous interest, and as Dr. Frieden just mentioned, it's usually underappreciated how much primary healthcare contributes to our health indices and our statistics. I'm going to give you just a very brief overview of how the system has evolved in Costa Rica, because we can't separate our policies and our system today from our history. And Costa Rica started investing in primary healthcare early on in the 1920s. The Secretariat of Hygiene was created, and then a law was enacted that was called the Law, the Protection of Public Health Law. And there were programs ongoing to fight against malaria, tuberculosis, leprosy, and the diseases that were the major burden of health in those days. The 1940s was a very, very important decade in defining our system. There was a lot of political turbulence back then. And in 1941, there was an agreement that was reached. It was a three-way agreement that was very unusual given the participants in this agreement. So Dr. Calderon Guardia, the president of the time, reached an agreement with his opposition, the Communist Party, and the Catholic Church. So if you can imagine that three-way agreement taking place back in the 1940s. It was very unusual. This agreement created the institution that I lead today, the Caja Costarricense Seguro Social, our social security system. It also created the University of Costa Rica, which is a public university and still one of our very top universities, and the labor code. So it implemented all the labor rights that we enjoy today. Now, that covered healthcare needs for workers. And then back in 1947, the Social Security system added pensions to its mandate. So the pension fund was launched in 1947. And since then, over all these decades, the coverage and the depth of care in the system has been increased in a stepwise fashion, from covering only workers in the beginning to then workers' families, and then the unemployed, and then the poor, and then legal migrants, and then undocumented migrants, and so forth. So it was a stepwise increase in coverage throughout all these decades. And there are many different points of decisions that were made over these decades. I can't name them all in the time that that I have available, but you know, different institutions were built up. The School of Nutrition was founded in the 1950s, the Health Directorate in that decade as well. The CEN-SINAI, which was and still is an institution that provides school meals for children and stimulus, educational stimulus for these children. Then in the 1960s, the official vaccination program was established. Our potable water institution was established in the 60s as well. And the School of Medicine of the University of Costa Rica and other institutions. And then in the 1970s, we had a national health plan. Latrines were established throughout the country. Childbirth was promoted to happen within our hospitals. And the sort of charitable hospitals back then were transferred to the Caja, the institution that I lead, the social security system. And so we started to unify the providers of care first at the hospital level. And then in the 1980s, we established our national health system. In the 1990s, there was another transfer of care providers. This time, the primary care providers to the Caja, our social security system. And so today, the Caja is the single provider of public health care services. So it was a stepwise fashion. First, the hospitals were transferred that did not already belong to the Caja. And then in the 1990s, all primary care was also transferred. So that included all the primary care clinics and the programs, the vaccination programs and all prevention programs. And if we fast forward today, the results have been quite remarkable in terms of bringing down infant mortality, maternal mortality, increasing life expectancy in a relatively short period of time. Now, the Caja is such an important institution. I have to say a little more about our institution. It has a constitutional mandate. So it's actually named in our constitution that the Caja will be the provider of Social Security services and will manage all of these services for the benefit of all the entire population of Costa Rica. It's autonomous. There is a board of directors that manages the ultimate decision making in the Caja. That board of directors has 9 members. 3 are named by the current and the administration in power at the time. There are 3 others that are named from the private sector, so they are the employers, and there are 3 that are named by labor. So it's sort of a mini Congress that takes place in our board. And no one has control. So there's constant negotiations going on. In addition, there's something that's very unusual. we are financed by payroll taxes primarily. So the employer pays part of the contribution to the system, and the employee pays another part. What's unusual is that the percent contribution is not defined by Congress. It is defined by the board of directors of the Caja, and it does not pass through Congress. So there is this authority that resides in the board, and this has allowed the Caja to be very resilient, even in times of economic crisis, that has allowed us to continue expanding coverage, deepening the level of care, and achieved what we have today. So what I would finish by just saying that over all these decades, there has been one constant theme throughout all of the administrations that have happened in these decades, and that is to broaden coverage, broaden the services that are provided by our system, which is a single payer, single provider public healthcare system. It's universal, and this has been shielded by this constitutional mandate. So it is very difficult to change that shielding because it is enshrined in our constitution. You need a very strong majority in Congress to do that. And at least until today, no one has dared to try to modify that. So I'll just leave it there. And I look forward to the question and answer period.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I look forward to exploring that further. It's a fascinating historical overview, bringing us right up to the present and outlining the importance of this agreement with the opposition, the communists, the Catholics, the government in the 40s, and this independence of the board of directors, not just on technical issues, but even extending to financial issues with a continuous improvement in coverage and service and performance. Thank you very much. Over to you, Dr. Viroj.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you. I listen carefully to Macaya, and it's so interesting. I think you didn't tell us about the fact that Costa Rica does not have army, so that you save huge resources for military and armed force that will free your resources to support social welfare sectors. I have the real indicators between the two countries with great interest, quite similar. Thailand has UHC service coverage index of 80%. An extremely low catastrophic at 2.2% of the household are facing catastrophic as measured by more than 10% of household income or expenditure was spent on health. And the MMR maternal mortality is 37 per 100,000 live birth. Although we have some problems on high incidence of tuberculosis, the area close to your heart, Tom. Health expenditure is 3.7% of GDP, much, much lower than the US of 18% GDP. And health workforce per 10,000 is not that high, 35.7 per 10,000 population, half of Costa Rica. You have 62. Doctor and nurses per 10,000 population. And we have a slightly lower income GNI per capita than Costa Rica. You have 11,000, but we have only 7,000 US dollar. So that's a brief of information. Similar to Costa Rica, our out-pocket payment is low, on par of OECD average of 13%. We have achieved 11%. That's why that means the facto indicate that the benefit package for the whole population is very deep, and free at pump service, no co-payment at all. I'd like to draw your attention that we start to increase coverage, service coverage, and financial risk protection to the whole population since 75. At that time, Tom, you may recall Indochina War. And there's a theory called domino theory that Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia become communist, and the next is Thailand. Therefore, the Communist Party of Thailand has moving insurgency against the government, which is backed by CIA at that time during 70s, during the Vietnam War. So that means CIA intermediation into the Thai army government back has played a significant role. That the government and the royal family has become too aware that we have to convince the population by comprehensive rural development. So health is part of that comprehensive rural development. Since 70s, we have a policy to increase coverage of district hospital for every district. By 1990, out of 800 districts, we have 800 district hospital. Bed range from 30 beds to 150 beds. And all province have provincial hospitals. That is the decade of district hospital development. And that followed by decade of health center development, aiming for a full geographic coverage. So that means the close to client services has been achieved by 1990. So we spent 30 years in supply side development, notably in the district health system. A health center cover 5,000 population on average, and a district hospital cover 50,000 catchment population. So that means in a district, we have a district hospital as well as 10 to 15 health centers formed into a network of primary care. So implicitly, the PSC in Thailand means we refer to health centers and the district hospital, which provide primary care as well as secondary care. So I will come to ensuring supply side is available and functioning in parallel of expansion of physical infrastructure. Rapid scale up of nurse and doctor is a parallel policy. In parallel with produce more, we retain more by introducing mandatory rural services for doctor, nurse, midwife, dentist, and pharmacist since 1972 until today. So I was in batch 9 of that batch, now it's 40, 50 batch. And at the same time, we cannot rely on teaching hospitals because they are not that high capacity to scale up rapidly. Therefore, we have MOH regional hospital become an average teaching hospitals. So pre-clinic and year one, which is basic science, 2 years pre-clinic was trained in university. Clinical year 4, 5, and 6 has been separate. Some in university hospital, some in MOH affiliate hospital. We have these 19 MOH teaching hospitals. So that means we can scale up supply side capacity. At the same time, when we have a rapid district hospital scale up, we train technical nurse 2 years, and you have to work 4 years and do go back another 2 years for a bachelor nurse training. So a laddering training program for nurse when we have a rapid scaling up of supply side. So this make primary healthcare district health system workable, functioning. Now, by 1990, we have introduced a social health insurance for formal sector employee. Since 1975, we have low income scheme and expand to not only to the poor, to the old person, to under 12 years old. 1990, we have social health insurance, which is a payroll tax finance scheme. Until at the same time, government employee also covered by civil servant medical benefits scheme. Until 2001, that there is a landslide political window of opportunities that opened, then we achieved universal coverage for the whole population. Most importantly, we introduced capitation contracting model to primary care. So that means we safeguard financing of primary care. by ensuring that capitation or adjusted capitation is provided to a district hospital contracting provider network. And we separate inpatient payment by a DRG system under global budget. All the achievement has been published, similar to Mexico, Turkey, and Costa Rica, very much exemplary outcome. Now, what is the function of primary care? It is a comprehensive first entry point of service for the citizen, with as a coordinator of services, they refer up to provincial hospitals for treatment, for diagnostic, and refer back from district hospital to health center from provincial hospital to district hospital. So interlink between health center district and provincial hospital is ensured through financial mechanisms. Most importantly, the COVID has been a good proof that the public health function was fully integrated in district hospital. So we have capacity on a routine basis to investigate dengue outbreak, to control outbreak, to have case investigation. So a day to day, these trends has been tested by a strengthening of surveillance and rapid response team. So that is a social asset for COVID response. I would pause here and invite further comment from you.
Thank you so much. This is exciting because I think we've seen some striking similarities. One is the payroll tax in both countries. Two is the unification, really, of public health and primary care in both countries. And these may be really important lessons globally. Let me first clarify a few things. Is it the case that the payroll tax essentially cross-subsidizes care for non-employed poor or who are not subject to the payroll tax? First, Dr. Viroj, and then Dr. Macaya.
Payroll tax cover less than 15% of population who are formal sector employee. And general tax covers civil servant medical benefit scheme. It's non-contributory scheme for government employee because in general, it was said historically that government employee receive a quite low salary. So this is a fringe benefit. The remaining 75% of populations, we have almost 70 million people, are covered by general tax finance scheme, which is we call UC scheme. So it's I would say in Thailand, the dominant part is general tax finance scheme. And this is seamless transition. For example, COVID, unemployment about 0.7 million unemployment was de facto transfer to be a UC scheme members, which is a tax finance. And so far, UC scheme is belong to the citizen, not belong to Thai Lak Thai Party who initiate as a political manifesto in 2001 general election.
So the bulk of the revenues are from general, not from the payroll tax. And Dr. Macaya, does the payroll tax, do the workers essentially pay for care for the poor in Costa Rica? Is this how it works, the non-salaried poor?
Well, it's actually a three-way financing system. So our system is based on the principle of universal coverage, but also universal contribution. So there is mandatory contribution for all workers and employers, and workers can also be independent workers that work for themselves. The state is the third source of financing, and the state wears two hats. The state is an employer, so the state pays as any other employer in the private sector. And then the state also contributes as the state itself. So there is a contribution that is independent of employment. There are programs that are specifically funded through general taxation. And in addition, in the payroll scheme, the state is a small contributor to that three-way sort of payroll tax contribution.
And Dr. Viroj spoke of capitation. Is in Costa Rica, is capitation an important part of the model?
I would say yes, in that the budget is defined and hospitals get their budget. And essentially that's what they need to do, what they need to do with for the year. So there is no reimbursement. We fund the budget of each hospital and of the primary care system, and then they have to make do with that budget. Now, there are also some areas of the country that are covered by third-party providers from the private sector that are contracted by the Caja, and they are paid on a capitated basis. So yes, the answer is yes, we have a capitated system. It's perhaps a little unusual to talk about that when you're sort of funding yourself. The Caja is a single payer, single provider. So we raise our own funds. We are the collectors of those funds. We own and operate 29 hospitals, 106 big clinics, and what we call the EVAIS, which are these primary care teams. And we have 1,057 of them throughout the country. And just to put some context, Costa Rica geographically is about a little over 50,000 square kilometers, about the size of West Virginia. And we have a little over 5 million people in our population.
And how do you balance hospitals from primary care? All over the world, and the US is no exception, we see hospitals gobbling up the resources, but not delivering much health improvement compared with primary care. Dr. Viroj and then Dr. Macaya.
We manage to fund hospitals' admission services through global budget. And under that global budget, we use DRG, and Thailand developed its own DRG now, version 6.2. DRG means diagnostic related group. So that means one outcome, we pay one single payment base rate. Now one relative rate for the UC scheme, it was around 8,000 baht. So for C-section 1.0, so you've got 1.5 of 8,000, and it depends on complication. So that safeguard and separate out from a primary care outpatient. Primary care outpatient, we pay on a capitation basis and fine-tune by it adjusts the more elderly registry in your network, in your catchment population. You get a slightly higher capitation. And that capitation will cover for the whole year or any outpatient services. And primary care contractor provider will also serve as a gatekeeper in referral. Therefore, some province has earmarked part of the capitation as a central manage for cross contracting provider network. So they pay. So that means we try to equalize the service capacity throughout the country. So that means there are two separate pot, big pot of resources. One for inpatient, so we safeguard outpatient by capitation. And how we estimate capitation rate, it depends on the use rate and the cost of unit, cost of provision. So P and Q multiply is a capitation rate.
Dr. Macaya?
Well, we have all of these, this network of clinics, but also of primary care teams throughout the country. And these teams are designed to cover a community of about 4,500 people. So if you go back to the number I gave earlier, 1,057 primary care teams distributed throughout the country, a population of about 5 million, we still have a gap. So there's always political pressure at the grassroots level and the communities to fill in those gaps. Everyone wants one of these primary care teams, which consists of a general practitioner, a nurse, a pharmacist, what we call an ATAP, which is a technical assistant of primary care. These are people that go into the community. They know the community members. They vaccinate people. They're a real source of information and of contact. They are the gateway into our public healthcare system. And then we've got some sort of computer record clerks also that are constantly updating registries. And we have a electronic record system that connects all of our primary care teams, all our clinics, and all our hospitals. So you can bring up anyone's record anywhere in the country. Now, there's another point of our Constitution that I have to mention. I mentioned that the Constitution names our Social Security institution as the provider or the administrator of Social Security services, which includes healthcare and pensions. But it also has another article which basically states the right to life, which our Supreme Court has defined as a right to health and therefore a right to health care. And so whenever anyone has a need for a procedure or even a drug that might be a very expensive latest generation drug that can be in the hundreds of thousands of dollars per patient, if we don't cover it and the doctor, the treating physician has determined that that patient would benefit from that drug, we have an expedited review process within our Supreme Court, and they almost always rule in favor of the patient. So we have to cover that. That drives the hospitalization budgets, which is where we have all of these more sophisticated procedures. So there's kind of two counterbalancing forces. One is this constitutional mandate to cover all healthcare needs, which drives more and more sophisticated and costly services, but also a drive at the political level to expand our primary care coverage for this population throughout the country. And that is a population that is aging very quickly. And so everyone wants a doctor nearby their house from our institution.
It's striking the degree to which there is similar reliance on community health workers in both countries. I was in Thailand. The number, maybe it's not correct, the number that sticks in my mind is that there are something like 1 million health volunteers who work in the health system, and they perform very important functions. I think this is true in both cases. I believe perhaps the capitation is something that encourages the primary care system to use a wider range of health services, nurses, pharmacists, data entry clerks, community health workers. Anything either of you would like to comment further about the team-based care aspect?
Perhaps I can just add that our country is divided or covered by what we call health areas. And each health area has a large primary care clinic that then oversees all of these primary care teams with these groups that I mentioned, with the general practitioner and the nurse and the ATAP, which is that person that is really the link to the community. But we also have, in all of these areas, there are community-based and community-elected health boards, essentially. And they oversee and are sort of a community driver for improving quality and efficiency. They want to bring down waiting times for people to get an appointment and to complete out the basic package of primary care, but also of hospital care in their communities. And they wield a lot of a political power in our system.
Viroj, anything you want to add?
I'd like to also discuss with Dr. Macaya. We have health technology assessment capacity to verify any intervention must be cost effective. And cost effective ratio is one GNI per capita for one quality gain. So we cannot provide all new diagnostic or intervention to every citizen. So it is based on cost effectiveness evidence. And once it become a benefit package, then government guarantee that it is not an unfunded mandate. So budget is allocated accordingly. Therefore, we are so afraid of constitution challenge that Brazil and Mexico and Costa Rica, it will become a mess. Therefore, the court always rule in favor of the citizen. And sometimes citizen is backed up by pharma industry. Therefore, we are chilled by evidence on cost effectiveness in making our benefit package. Over.
I'm going to ask one more question and then we're going to turn over to the audience for questions. We have one already. It has to do with the private sector. How important is the private health sector, medical sector in each of your countries? And how do you think about that? How do you address it? Maybe Dr. Viroj first.
Private sector can fill the gap of primary care, in particular in urban metro area where government and local government is weak in providing primary care. In Bangkok, primary care is hopeless, literally no primary care, because all teaching hospitals, super tertiary care hospital, care for super specialist care. Therefore, we have some 60 BMA, Bangkok Metro Authority health center, and they are not that strong. Then we have to rely on contracting with private clinic. And if you lost sight, they cheat you. They cheat you all the time. Therefore, government, when you have contracting agreement with them, Dr. Macaya also can jump in and comment that how you regulate the private for-profit sector. And it happened last few months, they cheat by producing fake, et cetera. And then it come to a mess. In social health insurance system, we also contract private hospital and government hospital on equal footing, equal payment, and also the UC scheme managed by National Health Security Office, which is Caja, is contracting also some private providers. Then they have a strong pre-audit, post-audit, etc.
Dr. Macaya.
Yes, the private health sector in Costa Rica is a parallel system to our public system. So everyone is obliged to contribute into the public system. You cannot opt out. And so if you choose to go to a private provider, whether it's, you know, a family physician or a hospital, you're either going to pay out of pocket or you're going to have your own private healthcare insurance. But having that insurance does not allow you to opt out of the public system. So this would be essentially a backup insurance plan. And the public system usually covers about 80 to 85% of the physician visits and a lot of the care. Now, our system, as I've described it, our public system covers everyone pretty much. It's based on a universal coverage model. We have a constitutional mandate to provide any service or drug that would basically further someone's health. And so essentially everything's covered that can be clinically justified. There are no exclusions for pre-existing conditions. There's no co-payment. There's no deductible. So where does our system tend to fail? In timely access to an appointment or timely access to an elective surgery. If it's an emergency, you'll be treated right away. But if it's elective, you can wait. And that's where the private sector comes into play. So there, if you're willing to pay and you have the option of paying out of pocket or have a private health insurance, then you would go to the private sector, or many people do this, to get faster access to services. Now, our system, our institution has been making great strides in shortening those waiting times, but it's still not something that's sort of on demand as you would find in the private sector.
Okay, we're going to go to the audience or the participants now, the attendees, and I'm going to ask that the questions and the answers be succinct because we want to get to quite a few in the next 15 minutes or so, starting with Majid Al-Gunaid.
Thank you very much for this highly interesting round table on a very important topic regarding the primary healthcare politics. And actually, I think primary healthcare, since its launching, is an ideology. And also, there is this political dimension. I have maybe one comment regarding that, the differentiation between the primary healthcare as a system and the primary care as a level of contact, because also sometimes there is mixing between the two issues. And also that's bring another dimension about how can we think about providing primary healthcare as a system within secondary and tertiary care health facilities. I have two specific questions for both presenters. First one is how COVID-19 will reform primary healthcare systems, and especially for better preparedness and response and based on the lessons learned during the pandemic. Second question for Dr. Viroj about the capitation system and the capitation for the, is it for public providers and private? Is it only, there is a clear package for the this capitation system? Is it including also referral to secondary and tertiary care? Thank you, over.
Okay, very briefly, first, implications of COVID, and second, for Dr. Viroj, capitation, I think you've already said it involves both lumped, the primary and hospital care. So there's an incentive for the hospitals to get the primary care done well. Is that correct?
Yes, correct. For admissions, we paid on a global budget and DRG system. For outpatient primary care, we pay on the capitation. Therefore, if you refer for investigation, you have to be responsible to pay for referral services. But if the services is for admission, it's a separate pocket. On COVID implication, primary care is the backbone of contact tracing, test and trace. And 1 million village health volunteers support identifying people at a high risk of contact, as well as providing primary care services for NCD.
Dr. Macaya?
Yes, regarding the COVID outbreak, our primary care system has been really a godsend in the sense that we have these teams embedded in the communities. This has allowed us to detect and trace contacts more efficiently. Now there are so many cases, however, that we've sort of, you know, it became community transmission. And once you get that, it's very hard to keep that tracking. But that is the entry gateway into the public health system. And so based on that, people get tested, they get referred. We've had family physicians and these teams that make phone calls to all diagnosed patients of COVID. And they answer all their questions. These are people that have anxiety. They have all kinds of questions. And they track, they monitor through their phone calls. These are daily phone calls. When their system or their symptoms start to deteriorate, and they've gotten very good at detecting when we need to intervene to transfer someone to a hospital. 96% of deaths from COVID in Costa Rica have been in the hospital setting. So most people by far that need a hospital get a hospital. And so the key is to get them there early enough. And that's where a lot of this primary healthcare backed by certain centralized functions that have included family doctors has been very important.
Great, let's go on to Kathy Ward from the World Bank.
Thanks very much. A wonderful presentation. Thank you for pulling it together and for all the information. I mean, it's clear what stars your countries are, and also you've just done a fabulous job sort of really making it clear how much this is a journey. It's layer after layer after layer. But what really struck me was that you both started by talking about a political moment, a political commitment, a political will. And I think obviously a lot of other countries are still sort of looking for that, or they're still working on that. And I'm wondering, how do you think we can build, how other countries can go about building not just political will, but political commitment? And in that regard, do you see, looking again at COVID, like, do you see places for quick wins that you would encourage others to maybe sort of seize on, whether it be in the COVID context or other things that you see happening right now, either thematically or things that are happening in particular countries or regions? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. That question is the crux of the reason for this roundtable. So let's start this time with Dr. Macaya. How would you recommend that a country try to build the secret sauce, the magic combination that you have of this political commitment to health generally, but to primary care specifically?
Yeah, that's a tough question to answer, because it's so country, the context of history is so important with that seminal agreement in 1941. That got the whole system formalized within our institution. And one thing I didn't mention is that in 1948, we had a brief civil war, and the victorious side of this civil war was in the opposition from the administration that had implemented the system, that had reached that agreement in 1941. And at the time, people thought that this new leader would do away with these reforms and these creations. And in fact, what he ended up doing is actually deepening the commitment and then abolishing the army, as Dr. Viroj pointed out, that freed up a lot of funding that used to go to the military and now goes into education and health. So separating history from current context is difficult, but I would say communities like having family doctors and access to a health team, a primary healthcare team in their community. And they feel the difference. They know that's the gateway into the system. And the results in terms of health indices speak for themselves. So I would say separating the history, which is very, you know, country related, that you can look at the data and make the case for improving health indices and access with primary healthcare teams embedded in the communities.
Thank you, Dr. Viroj.
To respond to Kathy, thank you for your good question. I think the strategy that we implicitly apply in Thailand for the last four decades is to make service available and equitably distributed through a full geographical coverage of primary care. So make service available, and government has to tolerate some catastrophe because the fiscal space is still low. When the political window of opportunity opened in a general election in 2001, then you just hit hard and make USC as a political manifesto. And the party who won the election just keep their promise. So we just achieved within a year to fill the 30% uninsured in a year. But I would say that the reform in Thailand is, as Joe Harris said, It is a reform, Miss Bureaucrat, driven reform. Because the health secretary, DG in the MOH, are exposed to district hospitals before. Therefore, they saw the pain suffering from cerebral malaria, backwater fever, TB meningitis. Tom, you may recall TB meningitis, big head of hydrocephalus from TB meningitis. And Kawachioko, marasmus, I have seen. All this public health leader become a bureaucrat, reformist or reformist bureaucracy. So reform within from the MOH push for a universal supply site in all district, in all sub district. So that is a cornerstone for implementing financial risk protection. Otherwise the government promised a blank is right in the papers. So I think make service available first and then gradually targeting the poor, the elderly, the informal sector, the formal sector, and then cross the job by the whole population in 2001.
Thank you. I'm going to ask another question. If any attendees have questions, please use the raise hand function to alert us to that. In both of your countries, heart disease and stroke are the number one and number two causes of death. Primary healthcare services the world over have focused on addressing either felt needs, such as painful conditions that bring people in, or maternal child health, including childbirth, immunization, child health issues. As the world changes so that heart disease and stroke are now our leading causes of death, primary care systems will need to adapt. And full disclosure, my group Resolve to Save Lives is focused on improving care of hypertension globally and seeing if there are countries that can get to very high rates of control based on strong primary healthcare systems. What are the things that you're thinking about in each of your systems to improve NCD care, prevention of heart disease and stroke? And are there areas where you think there are successes that can be learned by others and areas where you think there are future challenges for your system? We'll start with Dr. Viroj this time.
IHPP has conducted a major work on effective coverage of DM hypertension in the last 3 years. And effective coverage for diabetic is A1C below 6 or 7% as a well controlled. And the figure is not that good. In particular, in urban primary care, the function is not so well managed. Then we are struggle with, we know the cost, but the solution is quite difficult. The cost of those who are diagnosed and some are not treated, not many, but those who are diagnosed, treated, is not so well controlled. But for the high end, we have stroke and STEMI, we have stroke fast track, and the outcome is extremely positive in terms of full recovery and quite well established of intermediate care. At the same time, we have STEMI fast track and the gold standard for time to meet needle for TPA has been established and we save life. Now I think in a few years from now, we observe a reduction of mortality from both stroke and STEMI, the cardiovascular diseases. But on the prevention side, we have to see a new way of doing business. I like to invite Tom to visit Thailand when the COVID has been subsided and to see how we collaborate. And you should learn from your work. You are unmute. You are mute.
Thank you. We work with World Health Organization and others in Thailand. And we think Thailand is currently at more than 40% control of hypertension on a population basis, based on gold standard analyses. This compares quite favorably with the global average of about 14%, 14, compared to about 40. It's not dissimilar from the US or UK percentage, respectively 44%, and last I've seen about 36% from the UK. Nowhere near Canada, which is close to 70% and probably one of the top, but certainly compared to India and China, which are about 10 to 15%, quite a bit higher. So I think this focus on control can be extremely important. Dr. Macaya.
Yes, well, this is definitely the burden that we deal with is heart disease, cancer, diabetes. This is what we have to deal with on a daily basis, much more than infectious diseases, except for this pandemic, of course. But the primary care teams that are throughout the country that we call EBITES and that have these assistant technicians in primary care, the ATAPS, that go into the community, they have very well mapped out who has what. As I mentioned earlier, we have an electronic record system. Basically, we are constantly recording and documenting and storing in databases the medical history of our population. Anytime a person goes to any hospital or clinic, we can see their history, and it could be something that took place, you know, a visit in a different part of the country a few or weeks or months earlier. So there are programs that are designed to try to control these cases of, you know, who has hypertension, who has their diabetes under control. And we focus on education. So there are visits and sort of lectures within the communities on how to control these primary diseases that are such a burden on our system and on our population. And certainly the aging population in Costa Rica, which is the key driver of all this, you know, basically forecasts that demand for education and for control of hypertension and diabetes is just going to skyrocket. So we've got to keep up with this. We have a very high longevity late in life. So our life expectancy at birth is about 80, so about 78 for men, about 82 for women. But at the age of 90, for those who reach 90, we have the longest life expectancy in the world. We even surpassed Japan, a future life expectancy after 90. And it's a very interesting characteristic of aging because it's primarily contributed by the men. So women still outlive the men, but for example, a 90-year-old woman in Costa Rica lives about, on average, the same as a 90-year-old woman in Japan. But a 90-year-old man in Costa Rica will outlive a Japanese 90-year-old by quite a bit. And so the average turns out to bring us to this very high longevity. And with that comes, you know, all the chronic diseases and so forth that we're seeing with this transition to a very quickly aging society, where in addition, fertility rates have plummeted. You know, we have rates about 1.6 childbirths per woman today.
Great. Well, we're at time. I'm going to just summarize 6 key lessons, 1 key challenge, and then thank you both for really a scintillating discussion and enormously important. First, a political consensus in both countries. Second, capitation. Third, the important contribution of payroll taxes to funding the system. Fourth, an extensive use of community health workers and the full team. Fifth, the integration of healthcare and public health so that the public health teams are embedded in the healthcare system. And sixth, the existence of care in the community that is strong enough and effective enough and seen as a gateway enough so that people greatly value the community health services in their area. And now the challenge, which country will get to 50, 60, 70% hypertension control first? Because this will really not only reduce your mortality, but reduce your reliance on STEMI and rapid treatment of stroke and the healthy life expectancy, not just life expectancy, but life expectancy without dementia, without stroke, without disability from cardiac or other causes. This is, we think, the number one challenge for primary care in the coming years. We think there are ways through it. And we think there are probably no countries in the world better positioned than Thailand and Costa Rica to show us the way. So thank you very much. It's been a great discussion, and we look forward to ongoing collaboration. And thanks to all of the attendees for being with us and for the great questions that we had as well.